We can extend customer VRFs across several core routers using multiprotocol BGP. I've mentioned a few times throughout this series that VRFs are local to each router. One router doesn't know anything about VRFs on another router, but this can present a problem. Picture a service provider network. The core of the network is likely made up of many routers, and they have many customers connecting in. It's not scalable to configure every VRF on every router. The effort required for that is immense. Instead, we can extend BGP in the core to share customer routes independent of VRFs, while still keeping customers separate from each other. Routers on the edge still run VRFs, of course. As usual, it's easier to see it in action, so let's take a look at the lab. We're going to build our core network by adding another core router. Connected to this is another customer A and customer B router. Loopbacks are again used to simulate customer networks. The ultimate goal will be to forward network traffic between customer routers across our core. This means sharing route information while keeping customers separate from each other. The lab files are on the website, of course, so you can follow along or practice on your own. I'd just like to mention that what you see here is a lab and does not follow all the best practices that you would hope to see in the real world. We've seen some of this before, so I'm going to move through this fairly quickly. Here we're creating the VRF and enabling IPv4. We add the transit link to the VRF and add the IP addresses back in. Now we're starting the OSPF process and advertising the transit link. Now over to the customer router. We start OSPF, advertise the networks, and form a neighbor relationship. Same as in the last video, we change the network type on the loopbacks. Now we can move over to customer B. This part will be quite quick too. We create the VRF. We add the link to the VRF. And we advertise the transit link into EIGRP. On the customer router, we also configure EIGRP. When the transit link is advertised, the neighbor comes right up. And finally, we quickly double check that we have connectivity. Now it's time to get BGP running between the core routers. There's a single link between the core routers. This is a routed link with the network existing in the global routing table. We're starting on the core 2 router. There's a few simple things that we need to get ready first. This includes a loopback interface. This is used as the BGP router ID and the IP used for IBGP communication. We're also adding a static route to get to the loopback of the other router. And now we can configure an IBGP neighbor. As this is IBGP, I'm using a loopback interface as the source of my BGP traffic. This uses a global routing table, so there's no need for any VRF commands. Core 1 already has some BGP config like a loopback interface. We do need a route to get to Core 2's loopback though. It's the same BGP config here, nothing special at all. Except that I regularly have problems spelling neighbor. Does anyone else outside the US have that problem? Is it just me? Anyway, moving on. We'll stop manually advertising the customer networks that we set up in the last video. We're moving to an automated setup here. And we'd better just check that the neighbors are fine. And it looks like the neighbors aren't up yet. Okay. Just give me a moment, I'll figure that one out. Right, I've got it now. Due to my typo earlier, I didn't actually enter the neighbor command correctly. There we go, it's up now. This has been pretty basic so far. Nothing you haven't seen before, I'm sure. But now, it's time to make things a little more interesting. When BGP learns a prefix, what does it do? It stores in a database, right? But this presents a little bit of a problem. We have customers, and we want to keep them separate. There's even some overlapping IP space in our case. If all the prefixes are in one single BGP database, won't they all get mixed up? Won't the overlapping IP address ranges conflict somehow? Well, there's good news on this front. With a bit of assistance from us, BGP is smart enough to handle this situation. We can give each VRF an identifier called a route distinguisher. When a route is added into BGP, the route distinguisher is added with it. This keeps each prefix unique in the database. The route distinguisher itself is a 64-bit value. It is usually broken up into two 32-bit values, separated by a colon like this. It's a good idea to use your local autonomous system number as the first part. That's the 65,000 in this example. The second part is usually a number that you choose to represent your VRF. You have to choose a different number for each VRF to keep them unique. Route distinguishers are unique to every device. That means we don't send them to any other router in any way. To configure an RD, well, that's really simple. We just enter the VRF and we set the route distinguisher with the RD command. You might remember doing this on the Core 1 router for customer B in the last video. We're using the value of 10 for customer A and 20 for customer B. Any numbers will do really, as long as they're unique. It's really easy to check what the RD is set to. Just use show IP VRF. We can also see this on the prefixes in the BGP database. Notice that now they're called VPN V4 prefixes. We've added a little bit more information to the prefix now, that's the route distinguisher, so it's not simply an IP route, at least not from BGP's perspective. Core 2 doesn't have any prefixes yet. After all, we haven't given it anything to learn. We'll take care of that in just a moment. If we want, we can grab a bit more information by adding the detail keyword. Our customers are running their own IGPs, and in the core, we're running BGP. To get them to work together, we need to enable redistribution. We already redistributed BGP routes into customer B on this router during the last lab, but we still need to redistribute both into BGP. And it's the same deal on the Core 2 router. We need to redistribute BGP routes into the customer's IGPs, as well as redistributing the IGPs into BGP. Now we can double check that the customer routes are in the BGP database. Looks good here. Let's check on the other core router. And it's good too. But notice that we only see routes from the customer routers that are directly attached. We don't see all the customer routes yet. This is what we're going to configure next. So far, our core routers are joined by a single link. This link is in the global routing table. So, how can we get routes from one VRF across this link and back into the correct VRF on the other side? Routes can be passed over the link in the middle, but they need to be kept unique. A route distinguisher cannot help here, as they're local to each router. Instead, we can put a tag on each route to identify them as belonging to a particular customer. This part of the process is called exporting. This tag is called a route target, and it looks very much like a route distinguisher. In fact, we often use the same value for both. Remember though, that while they look the same, a route target and a route distinguisher are different things. A route distinguisher keeps a prefix unique in the local BGP database, while a route target is used to keep a route unique when passing from one router to another. When a router receives the prefix, it looks at the tag and puts it into the correct VRF. This part of the process is called importing. Let's now take a look at how to make this happen. We configure route targets within the customer's VRF. There are two parts to this. The part we're doing here is exporting. This takes all the routes in the VRF and adds the customer's tag to it. We've used the same value as the route distinguishers simply for convenience. They are completely separate things and we could use different numbers if we want to. But exporting is only half the process. When we receive routes from another router, we need to import them into the correct VRF. Here, we tell the router to import any incoming routes tagged with 65,010 into customer B's VRF. Hold on a sec, that's my mistake there. That's supposed to be 65,020 into customer B. We'll put routes tagged with 65,010 into customer A. And of course, we do the same thing on the other core router. A little configuration trick to make things a bit quicker is to use the both keyword. This both imports and exports in one command. We're almost done. We just need to make some small changes to the neighbor relationships between the core routers. We need to go into the VPN v4 address family. IPv4 routes with a route target attached are called a VPN v4 prefix. We activate the neighbor on this address family to get the routers to share these prefixes. As soon as we do this, we see a change in the peering. New capabilities have been added. Route targets are sent as a BGP extended community. That means we also need to enable communities here. Because this is IBGP, we'll also enable next hop self. We'll do the same thing on call 1, of course. And we still see the neighbors adding new capabilities as soon as they're activated. If we verify the routes in both VRFs, we can see that all customer routes have now been learned. The same is true on the second core router. And if we look at the customer routers, we also see that the routes have been learned there as well. They show up as inter-area OSPF routes, or external EIGRP routes. Time to see it in action. Let's ping from a customer router on one side of the network to the other side of the network. And that's working first go. It never works first go. Something's not right. Yep, I'm pinging the local networks. Of course that'll work. Okay, if we ping the right networks, they'll fail. That's what we're expecting to see. But all the routes are in place. We've just seen that. So what's actually going on here? Remember that all we've done is configure this environment to learn routes. But there's more to networking than just learning routes. Consider this transit link. Did we put these interfaces into a VRF? No, we didn't. They're in the global routing table. So traffic in a customer network can't reach the next hop. This is traffic segregation in action. So what are we supposed to do? An interface can't be in more than one VRF, so that's not an option. We could run a separate link for each customer, but that has scalability issues. What if we had hundreds of customers? We need a technology that encapsulates customer traffic and sends it over this link, something like a VPN. The most common technology in this case is Mpls. Mpls is a label switching technology. It takes a packet, places a label on the front. That traffic is then forwarded over the link using the label rather than just the IP address. No IP addresses means that the global routing table is no longer a problem. When the packet reaches the other side, the label is removed and the original packet is forwarded as normal. For our simple lab, configuration is easy. we just go into the interfaces for the transit link and enter the MPLS IP command. When we do this, a protocol called LDP forms a relationship between the two routers. LDP is the protocol responsible for assigning labels. And just like that, we can now ping from one side of the network to the other. That's a rather simplistic view on MPLS. There's a whole lot more than what we've talked about here. If you're interested in knowing more, let me know in the comments. VRFs are used to keep traffic completely separate. But what if we want to allow some of the traffic to mix? This is called route leaking, which is the subject of our final video.